Good evening, everyone. We would like you all to occupy the
from the love of liberty, in the fires of hope and prayer, with boundless faith in our destiny, we solemnly declare. May God bless our nation. Hear every creed and race find an equal place. And may God
Almighty God, most beneficial and merciful, Creator of the universe and embodiment of divine wisdom and light, we come before you with thanksgiving and praise. May your will be done in our nation as it is in the heavens. Please bless our political leader, party officials, activists, and all the people of Trinidad and Tobago. Give us the grace to always see good, be good, and do good, and the courage to serve the people. Protect us as we stand against injustice and iniquity, and inspire our endeavors to find the right solutions to the problems that are affecting our fellow citizens. Grant that we may always work together with humility and respect for the greater happiness of all and the honor and glory of our country. Amen. Is the United National Congress Virtual Report 2022. Tonight, your hosts, Rishi Bairam Singh and Shanti Bhutram.
The Honorable Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa, Senior Counsel, Member for Parliament for Siparia, Political Leader of the United National Congress, Members of Parliament, Senators, Councillors, Members of the National Executive, my brothers and sisters joining us here and on the World Wide Web, at our virtual report. Welcome and good evening. I am Shanti Budram, Councillor for the Electoral District of Pinal in the Pinal-Debe Regional Corporation. It is indeed an honor and pleasure for me, together with my fellow councillor for the electoral district of Les Efforts West Laramie, Rishi Balram Singh, from the San Fernando City Corporation, to host our UNC virtual report this evening. Our speakers this evening are men and women who have dedicated their lives to the service of the people of our beloved nation. Our first speaker is a known stranger to us. Mr. Sean Sobers was born and bred in the city of San Fernando. He has since made several contributions inside and outside of Parliament, holding the government accountable. Whenever they attempt to bring rushed and poorly constructed pieces of legislation, Mr. Sobers has also been tremendously active within the UNC, working at our many legal clinics across the country. He is now part of our national executive, working diligently as our policy officer. Let's put our hands together and welcome Mr. Sean Sobers.
And this revolution is about stopping this creeping dictatorship. This is the people's revolution.
Good evening to our honorable political leader, Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa of Senior Council. Good evening to our members of parliament of both houses. A special good evening to Mr. Kemraj Sicharan, our UNC candidate for the Debe South by-election and soon to be another UNC councillor for the Debe South region. A special good evening as well too to all persons viewing and listening to our virtual platform and to our UNC Nation family. Welcome to you this afternoon. This being my first opportunity to speak to you on this virtual platform, I thought to myself that I should bring greetings and salutations, well wishes for a happy new year. But then when I had a read of the newspapers and recognized that we are 49 murders, more murders than days that in this month of January, I recognized that it would not be a happy new year for most persons. It could not be a happy new year for persons who are struggling during this COVID-19 pandemic, persons who are under the brunt of this failing healthcare system, both the current healthcare system and the parallel healthcare system. It could not be a happy new year for citizens within our country who are not being able to access social services, the most vulnerable persons within our country not being able to procure those social services. It could not be a happy new year for many young people and young children who are unable to access proper education under this PNM administration. And it could not be a happy new year for most persons within our country who are plagued by the rising crime and criminality within our country. And that is why I'm here this evening. That is why most of us are here this evening, to bring a proper report to you, the citizens of this country, with the failing grade that is passing as governance within this country under the PNM administration, and in particular, with respect to crime and criminality. My friends, every story, inclusive of horror stories, which we are experiencing within this country, has a genesis, has a beginning. And this particular horror story has its genesis rooted with respect to an appointment made last year, April 2021. You see, around that time, the Prime Minister decided to shuffle his deck of jokers, and he appointed a particular joker in that of Fitzgerald Ethelbert Hines as your Minister of National Security. And Minister Hines comes with a certain degree of expertise in this ministry. He has the expertise of managing the Ministry of National Security through press conferences. an ability beyond all other ministers to spew vitriol and political propaganda at press conferences. And in terms of doing so, he does it in a particular fashion, unmatched by any other minister within the PNM administration, that he could turn a media press conference that is being hosted and held by persons who are sought to be independent within our country, members of the Trinidad and Tobago Police Service, members of the Trinidad and Tobago Prison Service, other members of the Ministry of National Security, independent press conferences, he chooses to transform it into a political platform to spew political propaganda. And we don't expect anything much more from him. And as of April, moving quickly down into June of 2021, we recognize another milestone under the PNM administration. Many persons would know that around that particular time, there was the tenure of the Commissioner of Police, Gary Griffith, coming to an end, and a responsible administration would have put things in place to ensure a seamless transition, either renewing the contract of Gary Griffith or transitioning to a new Commissioner of Police. But what did they do? We all know the settled fact that the Police Service Commission has the responsibility mandated under the Constitution, Section 123(1), to appoint through a process by order the Commissioner of Police or Acting Commissioner of Police, as the case may be. It should be a seamless process. It's a process known to us, one that has been established for quite some time. The process pursuant to this order created by the government that was being utilized all the time. There's a 2009 order, a 2015 order. We debated it just recently in Parliament. And those orders worked quite well. The PNM utilized those orders. They utilized those orders to appoint Gary Griffith in the first place. But for some reason, the orders fell out of favor. And the Attorney General at that point in time, Faris Alwari, decided that the order didn't work anymore. And he drafted a new order in 2021. And what was the result of that order? The order was drafted particularly to find favor for one person. What we in the legal profession like to call ad hominem legislation. Legislation specifically designed to favor one person instead of the masses. That is what was done. But that legislation did not find favor with the courts, because the court struck down the legislation and deemed it unconstitutional and ultra vires. The legislation also didn't find favor with Faris's cabinet colleagues. And why should it? This is the same man who, by virtue of a tweet, indicated to you that he was busy New Year's Eve night drafting legislation, firework legislation, that also found stark condemnation from his cabinet colleagues, that found stark condemnation from many persons within society. So it was no surprise that his cabinet colleagues took issue and umbrage with that legislation, that order of 2021. And what happened? Thereafter, you had all of these political interferences and interaction with this constitutionally mandated organization, the Police Service Commission, that is charged with this significant responsibility, an organization that was supposed to be independent, free from political interference. But that wasn't the case. You had playing out for the first time in the history of this country a chairman of this Police Service Commission carrying a document to President's house, being excited by some type of information, retracting a document, and then we were left with the first time in this history, no police commissioner. No police commissioner, no acting police commissioner, no one to pilot one of the most independent and important organizations within this country, responsible for peace and law and order within the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. But that is governance under the PNM administration, that they will attempt to interfere with something as sacred as the Police Service Commission to effect their will and their way. To hell with the Constitution. What is that? A piece of paper. They don't pay any respect or mind to that, but we've grown accustomed to that. And as we continue to divulge and delve deeper into this slippery slope of crime and criminality under the PNM administration, we move quickly on to November of 2021. And around that time, my friends, cast your mind back. You'd remember that the prison service came out with a press conference and indicated to the public that they'd stumbled upon a plot by prisoners incarcerated behind prison walls, a hit list for prison officers, a hit list for prison officers in this country, little old sweet Trinidad and Tobago. And instead of being a responsible, aggressive Minister of National Security, to come out and indicate and tell us as a public what the solutions would have been to that problem, he comes out and indicates, well, listen, it have a lot of prison officers who engage in nefarious activity, and this may very well be as a result of those activities. That is what he told us. That is what he told the members of the Ministry of National Security who serve in our nation's prisons. And while officers began to be slaughtered by the hands of members of those prisoners, he kept quiet. He kept quiet until that day in December of 2021. Many of us would remember that there are certain significant crimes that take place within our country that no matter how much prayers you can pray and that you can say, that will wash those crimes away. And this particular crime mirrored an event that took place about 2 years ago, where a mother was carrying her child to a graduation and she was gunned down in daylight. And in this situation, a father carrying his daughter to a taxi stand was gunned down. He wasn't gunned down at 6 o'clock in the evening. He wasn't gunned down at 10 o'clock at night. He was gunned down at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And he wasn't gunned down in some back street or in some alley. He was gunned down on a high street in this country. And what did the Minister of National Security do? Had a next press conference. And what did he tell you in that press conference? He didn't speak about that dead prison officer. He didn't speak about the aggressive solutions that he was going to mandate to take place that very said day to capture those perpetrators who committed such an atrocious act. No, he came out to tell you about some firearm report from OLEP, the Organization of Law Enforcement Policy in the Ministry of National Security. And that is the level of stark disrespect meted out by that Minister of National Security, Fitzgerald Hines, and the PNM administration. And we move along into December, where all of these things happening and playing out in the public domain are taking note by international persons in the international community. And there was an incident in December where two children, Venezuelan children, who found themselves here in Trinidad and Tobago looking for a better life to spend time with their father, who is legally here, were swept up by arms of the Ministry of National Security. A father who petitioned the Immigration Division to get some answers. And the bleeding heart that our leader, Mrs. Kamala Persad-Bisesa, has, what did she do? In the dead of the night, she telephoned all the lawyers of the party that we had to get together, and we all started to put together a writ of habeas corpus to rescue those children. And again, in the dead of the night, those children were deported without having had proper consultation with their father or any legal representative. That is governance under this PNM administration. That is how Fitzgerald Hines treats with his responsibility as Minister of National Security. And the sad tale of woe doesn't end there, my friends. At the beginning of this year, January 2022, when persons should be organizing themselves accordingly for a brighter and better day, where the tide should be turning, you have peaceful protesters in Queen's Park, Savannah, being shot at with tear gas. And a commissioner of police who's grown to be a mouthpiece for the government is coming out to tell you and to tell me that they were throwing missiles at the police. I want to ask the commissioner of police, how many of those persons that you allege that were throwing missiles were arrested and actually charged for throwing missiles? What about the body cameras that these police officers were supposed to have? How many of those persons were captured on those cameras actually throwing missiles? Was anybody actually ever throwing missiles? Or was that an excuse to utilize a weapon of destruction like tear gas on our citizens in a peaceful democratic process? That is governance under a PNM administration. And we call upon you, the citizens of this country, to reject that type of governance. What do we want as a responsible opposition? We want you to tell them no to activities like that. We want the Prime Minister to do the right thing for the first time in 7 years and fire Fitzgerald Hines as Minister of National Security. We want the Prime Minister and the Cabinet at large to give us real answers with what took place with respect to the Police Service Commission. We don't want any political interference in any organization, independent or otherwise, within this country. That is what we want as a responsible opposition. We want to highlight and bring to you, especially members of the public, to understand and appreciate the level of inequality being experienced within this country, something that I like to call PNM privilege. And what is PNM privilege? You all know it. PNM privilege occurs when the son of a minister who loses his phone, and within a matter of hours, all arms of the Ministry of National Security is activated to go and get back that phone. That is PNM privilege. What is PNM privilege? PNM privilege is when your family members benefit from millions of dollars based upon loans that you taxpayers have to repay. That is PNM privilege. PNM privilege is when you have family members making millions of dollars in rental income. That is PNM privilege. And PNM privilege does not only extend to persons within the PNM. You would think that because you are a card-carrying member of the PNM or you vote PNM, you'll be PNM privilege as well. No, sir. That is not the case. Because you still have to line up and look for a job. And the same jobs that they promised to give you, they aren't safe anymore. Because PNM privilege didn't extend to WASA workers. It is not going to extend to TSCT workers. It is not going to extend to port workers. It wouldn't extend to T&Tech workers. And it definitely didn't extend to persons working at Petrotrin. So we call upon you to say no to PNM privilege as well. And when we call upon you at election time or any other time to say yes to the United National Congress, to say yes to our members of parliament fighting both inside the parliament and on the pavement and back again, to say yes to our political leader, Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa, to say yes to transparency and democracy and good governance, and the only political party well poised to bring back good governance in Trinidad and Tobago is the United National Congress. Thank you very much, my friends.
Very well said, Mr. Subas. Not just a powerfully built man, but a powerful voice as well. Esteemed political leader, Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa, senior counsel, fellow colleagues, members of the viewing public, a special good night to you all. I am Councillor Rishi Balaram Singh for the electoral district of Lesofor West Larbin in the city of San Fernando, one of your co-hosts for tonight's proceedings. Our next speaker is a true stalwart. A familiar name, not just in the political arena, but also in the entertainment industry. Ravi has proven himself to be an all-rounded, dynamic individual. Being involved in the party for many years, Ravi currently serves as the party organizer on the national executive. Ravi has distinguished himself in the political arena by representing the UNC as the Shadow Minister of Agriculture, while he serves as our Member of Parliament for Coover North. He continues to advocate for all those constituents to have a better quality of life. He continues to represent the farmers and the fishermen. He continues to represent you, Coover North, and the UNC continues to stand with you. Put your hands together, ladies and gentlemen, for MP Ravi Ratiram.
Everybody sing freedom. Freedom. Everybody sing freedom. Man and woman sing freedom. Everybody sing freedom. Everybody sing. As we move in this people's revolution, my brothers and sisters, let's all walk together.
A pleasant good evening, brothers and sisters. Those of you joining us at our UNC virtual report from wherever you may be viewing or listening. A special good evening to my colleagues on the platform and our illustrious political leader and the best Prime Minister this country has ever seen, the Honorable Kamala Prasad Bisesa. Brothers and sisters, last week when we debated the Standing Finance Committee's report, the PNM tried to shut us down once again because they didn't want you to hear the truth. During those proceedings, brothers and sisters, we were told by the Minister of Finance, Colin Imbert, that under the Ministry of Agriculture, they saved over $12 million, and one of the areas which contributed to these savings was through deferring the desilting of water courses and road repairs for fiscal 2021. So last year, when our villages and towns flooded out in places that never experienced flooding, brothers and sisters, it was because our water courses were not being properly cleared by this PNM uncaring administration, even though there was fiscal allocation to do so. So when this PNM government tells you that they are rescheduling the desilting of water courses to next year, it does not instill any confidence that the job will get done. As a matter of fact, during that period in question, that is fiscal 2021, our farmers were severely affected by floods. I refer to a Trinidad Guardian article dated July 10, 2020. Chicken farmers clean Barakpur water courses. And this article reads, chicken farmers at Oropucha South Road, Barakpur, are calling on the relevant authorities to clean the water courses after thousands of baby chickens drowned in floods over the past few years. In another article from Loop TT, dated September the 2nd, 2021, with heading 150 farmers in Plumitan affected by recent flooding, says ministry. Another Loop TT article of March 16, 2021, ministry estimates $600,000 in claim to penal farmers after flooding. So at the end of the day, my brothers and sisters, there is a financial cost to our citizens when the Rowley PNM government take a decision to move a funding from the desilting of water courses and spend it elsewhere to benefit their friends, families, and financiers. Tonight, I want to ask you, brothers and sisters, whichever part of the country you may live, to forward to me via my Facebook page, Ravi Ratiram, MP for Coover North, any pictures, videos, and addresses of water courses to be cleaned in your area. And the UNC will be representing your issues by calling upon the government to identify the schedule of cleaning works for these water courses and hold them to account, my brothers and sisters. We will hold them to account. Another area in which the PNM is claiming savings is $25 million that was allocated to the Agricultural Development Bank. Tonight, I want to ask Prime Minister Keith Rowley, why is the PNM government gutting the ADB? Brothers and sisters, the massive increase in the price of food has reached crisis level. Poor and vulnerable farmers have been hit very hard, and families continue to suffer from increasing food prices, brothers and sisters. The spike in the cost of importing food has been a major cause of this price inflation. In this context, national food security has become of vital importance to every government across the globe, except for the Rowley-led PNM government. Through the PNM government, what we see is complete neglect to the agriculture society. Though the PNM government has given out interest-free loans to companies owned by their friends, their families, and their financiers, they continue to neglect our farmers and our fishermen. Farmers have been left high and dry during this economical crippling time of this pandemic. In fact, the PNM government slashed expenditure at the ADB in 2021 by $25 million. This further proves that Keith Rowley cares very little about the agriculture industry, farmers, and consumers in our nation. When asked in the recent Parliamentary Standing Finance Committee why the ADB was being gutted in this manner, the Minister of Finance could not offer any meaningful explanation, brothers and sisters. He ludicrously and cold-heartedly suggested that farmers were perhaps either not requesting loans or did not meet the criteria to access COVID-19 relief funds. So while farmers cannot meet the criteria to access loans where they have to pay 3.5 to 5% interest, while this government continue to suck the blood and sweat out of our farmers, their friends and financiers, the business community, continue to receive interest-free loan under Imbert and this Rowley PNM. And that is how the PNM cares about our agriculture society, brothers and sisters. It should be noted that the sole purpose of the ADB is to provide financial assistance for farmers in the development of the agricultural sector. If the ADB is not fulfilling its mandate, it means there is a deliberate attempt by the PNM government to neglect our farmers and fisherfolk and prevent them from accessing development loans. This means less income for them and higher prices in the market and groceries for the rest of us. I therefore call upon the Minister of Finance and the Minister of Agriculture to do their jobs and serve the needs of the farmers and fisherfolk of our nation. Those in the agricultural sector need equitable access to interest-free loans and other COVID-19 relief measures given to other sectors. Again, I ask, where have the billions of dollars in COVID relief been spent and on what? The government has a duty to assist our farmers. For the longer they are ignored, we can expect to see further increasing food prices, brothers and sisters. As we continue to talk about this Rowley-led PNM government and what they consider savings, I want, brothers and sisters, by now, the entire country to know what transpired at that segment of the Mosquito Creek, that highway to Point 14, segment 5A, of the San Fernando to Point 14 highway, the collapse of the roadway at the Mosquito Creek. I remember when our political leader not too long ago was speaking about the poor road conditions our citizens have been facing across Trinidad and Tobago. Our leader described the PNM as the pothole national movement. You all remember that? Well, brothers and sisters, it seems that Rohan and Rowley have decided to take it one step further. My colleague, the MP for Oropouch East, said last week, the people have now renamed the collapse of the section of the road along the Mosquito Creek as the Mosquito Crack, which will forever be attributed to the complete incompetence of Rohan Sinanan. One of the things mentioned by Dr. Munilal at yesterday's press briefing, which is worth repeating, is that not one inch of any part of that Point 14 highway project that was built under the leadership of Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa under the People's Partnership Government has up to this date collapsed. Not one inch has collapsed, brothers and sisters. It is amazing that this Minister of Works and Transport continues to mamagai and hoodwink the population by trying to make everyone believe that the shame that he and the PNM have brought upon our country is because they are trying to save money. I refer to an article in the Newsday dated around June 2018, Local Contractor Save Government Dollars, where this article says, and I quote, government's decision to use Tell me when. So, brothers and sisters, I do apologize for that technical difficulty that we have just experienced. And we were just speaking about the incompetence and the corruption within the PNM. And all of a sudden, our internet service got interrupted. I wonder if there's a direct correlation with the interruption that we just faced and the corruption inside the PNM. And I want the Prime Minister to answer that also. If that alone were not enough information to prove how uncaring, incompetent, and corrupt the PNM government is, let me tell you this, brothers and sisters. Two seats that have traditionally been won by the PNM are La Brea and Point Fortin, yet their constituents are treated with total disrespect and disregard. Almost the entire string of streetlights, and I want to share this video with you, almost the entire string of streetlights, brothers and sisters.
This is the highway to Point.
Who continuously supported the PNM after a hard day's work traversing on that part of the highway, going home, have to pass through that dark area, my brothers and sisters. Similarly, what is happening to the residents of Beetham with sewer flowing on the roadways, brothers and sisters, and that is how the PNM cares about the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago. Since the days of Dr. Eric William, they have been talking about a highway 2.14. But as our honorable political leader said last Monday, the PNM is like NATO. No action, talk only. So even though the PNM has been in office for some 30 to 40 years, they never started a highway 2.14. It took a UNC-led government under the prime ministership of Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa, the most caring and compassionate this leader this country has ever seen, to start that highway 2.14, brothers and sisters. And you know what? If the UNC had remained in office, that highway would have been completed 6 years ago. This, above all else, prove that Keith Rowley and his band of misfits clearly do not know what they are doing, how incompetent they really are. A Guardian media article dated January 27, 2022 by reporter Radhika De Silva interviewed the president of the South Oropouche Riverine Flood Action Group, Mr. Edward Modi. The article states that the group called on the government to immediately halt construction and instead focus on building proper infrastructure to accommodate the water flow from nearby marshlands into the sea. Mr. Modi went on record as saying, and I quote, "It has gotten worse. There is a sandbank forming in the Gulf of Paria that is about 50 feet to 75 feet from where the highway is sinking. The pressure of gravel is pushing under and coming out in the surface area. We measured the crack on the walls and it is 30 feet longer than it was yesterday." Brothers and sisters, since September last year, the newspaper reported Mr. Edward Modi calling for works to be done at the Mosquito Creek River. He said that several points along the river are in dire need of desilting and widening. This is necessary for the free flow of salt and fresh water to preserve the mangroves ecosystem, which forms part of the engineering design that the CEC made reference to. But what we see happening is that this PNM has no regard for the law, no regard for the environment, and no regard for public safety, brothers and sisters. This is because the PNM has created a parallel legal system, as explained by Senator Jayanti Lakshmidiyala last week, which they operate by. You recall Faris playing arm wrestling while his friends surrounded him during a time where everyone is expected to maintain social distancing. You recall Rowley boasting recently on national television that he breached the public health ordinance by drinking a beer in public, while Rowley and his 1% friends eat drink, and be merry playing golf and bouncing down people on the golf course. The rest of us suffer from flooding, from roads that are not fit to be called roads, from no water in our tap, broken sewer lines, high unemployment, and no food on our table, brothers and sisters. And for those who can afford, they continue to be affected by the high rising food prices under this uncaring PNM Rowley-led government. So brothers and sisters, at this time, we need to continue to be our brother's keeper, as we have been taught to do so by our honorable political leader, Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa. Her mantra to serve the people, serve the people, serve the people has taught all of us in the UNC how to be caring and compassionate and to be our brothers and sisters' keeper. So my brothers and sisters, we will continue to fight for your rights, for your children's future, and for a better day for our country and tomorrow's society. And surely, as the night follows the day, the sun shall rise again. Long live our honorable political leader, Kamala Prasad Bisesa. Long live you, the beautiful people of Trinidad and Tobago. I thank you.
Crying out for democracy. Now it's time to take a stand, yeah.
Come on!
'Cause this is the revolution, the people's revolution. This is the revolution.
Let's unite and stand for something.
This is the revolution. People's revolution. This is the revolution. I wanna hear everybody sing. Everybody sing freedom.
Thank you, MP Ravi Ratiram, for your powerful contribution tonight. My UNC family, now is the time to stand together and get rid of this blight called the PNM. Put your X by the rising sun. Vote UNC. Vote for our young and energetic candidate, Mr. Kimraj C. Sharon, for Davis South. Send a message. Rowley must go. Our next speaker is one of our young MPs, Michelle Benjamin, the Member of Parliament for Maruga Tablan. She is family-oriented and an active member of the Baptist community. Michelle is affiliated with a number of non-governmental organizations and youth groups. She holds a Bachelor of Science degree in Environmental and Natural Resource Management and Biology from the University of the West Indies. And she also holds people-centered representation close to her. MP Michelle led the charge of the People's Revolution demonstrations, which brought about the snap of a finger assessment of damaged roads. Maruga Tablan, never forget, MP Michelle stands with you. The UNC stands with you. Let's welcome MP Michelle Benjamin.
Democracy. And this revolution is about stopping this creeping dictatorship. This is the people's revolution.
Come on, people.
Good night, my UNC family. Good evening to my political leader, the Honorable Kamala Prasad Bisesa, members of the National Executive, my esteemed colleagues, and the wider viewing public. Thank you all for the support as tonight we continue to put a spotlight on this shameless, clueless, corrupt PNM government. As my fellow councillor, former councillor colleague would have said, as you would have known, I come from the local government bench. And as she said, God and religion and people is close to my heart. After God and being in his presence, our home is our safe place, our sanctuary. This country is home to Calypso, Steel Band, yes, and the greatest show on earth, Carnival. But let's be honest. For 6 years now, our culture has been left exposed by this wicked government to exploitation. And as such, this country, as it's pertained to culture, is no longer a safe place. But yet, they want to create a safe zone to impress who, I ask you. When our artists have to leave their home to perform in other festivals across the world, who value their contributions more than we do? As we hold the key, this is our culture. Our artists are suffering, but yet this government don't hear their cries. Their home is no longer safe. The Honorable Political Leader of the United National Congress, Ms. Kamala Prasad Bisesa, gave $2 million in prize money to each respective winner. But this PNM government allocated $23 million to Faris Alwari, and yet nothing for the suffering artists. PNM, a blight, clueless, corrupt government. In our land of creatives, the PNM is showing how unimaginative and clueless they really are. In 2022, the Minister of Tourism is boasting of a taste of carnival, like he didn't borrow, as we say, thief that line from KFC's 2021 carnival promotion last year. Like they thought we would not have noticed that blunder. How could they do us that? The land of Calypso, Steel Pan, and Carnival cannot host a safe festival. Whilst our artists perform in other festivals, they were prepared to go in Miami Carnival last year, October, and now they are preparing for Atlanta Carnival. They are not preparing for Carnival in Trinidad and Tobago, and we are the home to the greatest show on earth. Our artists are suffering and deserves to be treated with more respect as the most this government is not minded about the people suffering. This government is not people-oriented. This government is not culture-oriented. Meanwhile, citizens are shaking their heads in confusion, utter shock of the ill-thought-out plan of a safe zone carnival, which can only benefit a selected few. These carnival 2022 plans have more cracks than the Mosquito Creek. The PNM government flip-flopped on carnival from the very beginning, from Faris Alwari announcing the mother of all carnivals to the Prime Minister coming back and stating that he's not sure that there will be one. Then back again to him saying that there might be a safe zone version. To now this final NCC version that leaves more questions than answers. Then of course now, we have, rightfully so, the Fed promoters expressing disinterest and disappointment in the PNM's approach. More crack, I tell you, than the Mosquito Creek. Which stakeholders did the ministry really consult with? Because the word from mass bands, wire benders, and artists is that it is already too late to host 2022 Carnival. 3 weeks is not enough. With the announcement being made on the 19th of January, the carnival industry is left with only 3 weeks. Viewers, 3 weeks to do the greatest show on earth. But the PNM thinks that is enough time. The PNM has continued to ignore the voices of our nation with their continued dictatorship style of government. The UNC's position is that we don't need this right now. Let us focus on our nation's safety, on the cry of the people. Yes, we know our culture is important, but we need to be safe. We need to listen to what our stakeholders are saying. We need to be their voices. Ladies and gentlemen, let's listen to what our stakeholders are really saying. Master wirebender Richard Lira from Belmont was quoted in the Express article on 28 January 2022, and I quote, 3 weeks is not enough time to build a costume. Ronnie McIntosh of Ronnie and Caro Mass Band said, in an interview with the Express, that I have no idea what they mean by carnival is on. The mass is not a today for tomorrow thing. It consists of long-term planning, so there is nothing we could do at this time. Even in our sister isle, the head of the Tobago Business Chamber, Martin George, is of the opinion that government should forget about staging any kind of carnival activity. for 2022, especially for Tobago, he says. It does not appear realistic or feasible. Clearly, the PNM is ignorant of these art forms, and so expect the entertainment industry to come running to half-baked ideas. This is disrespectful and foolish. Is this the objective of a Taste of Carnival, to benefit everyone else, I mean Faris, except for those who really rely on Carnival as their livelihood? Apparently, it is easier for this government to approve party boats in the name of restaurants overnight on Boxing Day for Mr. Schoon, apparently the AG's best friend, than to invest energy and time and resources necessary to plan Carnival 2022. Ladies and gentlemen, the fact of the matter is that more time is needed to plan and execute a safe Carnival, not just a taste to benefit the selected few. This is not a super deal from KFC. This is our culture, our lives, and our livelihoods. The PNM government, I say to you, the PNM government prefers to pay Faris Alwari $23 million. And look at the state of our roads. I will show you a video of the state of the roads in Murga Tableland and our bridges in Lengua Indian Walk. I tell you, if you see the state of our roads after $178 million was awarded.
Yeah, it's real terrible, boy. And we're talking about the pieces going across, huh?
Yeah. Yeah.
We fold back up all the pieces. Look, you see we're using bowlers to pack it back up. To try and, you know?
Yeah.
Make sure we could pass them.
We're
begging, we're pleading for the longest while. Right? Look, our little cousin just take in. And we had to rush him to the hospital. Right? This is the only source in and out. If this is working.
It's a long...
Where we go? We can't go through the front.
Oh.
The front condemned.
Right?
Yeah, we in the middle of boat. By Robin Singh, we can't go out in the front there. They totally could hardly walk. Right? And well, this is the only way out of here. It had the Perryong branch road. It is not suitable. Because that road is, according to your vehicle, well, yeah, it suits the terrain. So it's not suitable. It's just here. And what's the condition? We as the residents were still trying to patch it up and do a thing so we could come out. As I see my little cousin now taking, and we had to rush him, you know? What would have happened if this
wasn't it,
you know?
Mm-hmm.
What would have happened? The ambulance even coming. You know? What's the condition of it? It's over terrible, man. It's over terrible. The first thing they're saying is COVID, it's COVID, they can't do this, they can't do that. But all kind of things being done. What's this piece here, brother? What's this piece? I just drive a truck, right? So I have to know how I come in with my truck. You dig? Watch here. Right? So this is the boards who are going, right? Road to road. And the ones who are going across, rotten out underneath that. So watch underneath that day. You understand? Gosh, man, and can't fix this? What you railing? Huh? It rotten off and fall off. The lucky the iron men never go on with it yet. We put it on the side. It's over disgusting, man. The people living in here. You know? Children. You know? You understand? And the claim said the children
nobody
is the
teacher. Lives there.
Come on. Enough time when the trees and all branches breaking off constantly, falling on the bridge. Thank God it had fallen a vehicle. Gosh, man. Why you do something? Please.
So as you see in that video, and that is one of the five bridges that I have in a deplorable state. We have Glod Road, we have Edward Trace, we have Warwell, and we are calling on the Minister of Works to hear the cries of the citizens of Murga Tablan. We are asking you that $178 million that was awarded in 2017 and was supposed to be completed in 2019, come and have a look at what is going on. Projects that were completed are falling apart. Murga Tablan is coming similar to that Mosquito Creek. Everything is failing and falling apart underneath this wicked and corrupt PNM government. We need to hold them accountable for our taxpayers' dollars. Trinidad and Tobago, stand with the United National Congress. I say to you, if these people are not attending to our roadways, our hospitals, the lack of devices for our children, and also the failure of this government to support the entertainment industry and the rest of the struggling citizens of Trinidad and Tobago, Trinidad and Tobago, let's vote them out. The Prime Minister sympathizes with Faris Alwari's bank account and has preferred over the years to support him, his family, and his friends. Bold-faced corruption. What Worley is saying then is hard luck to the ordinary poor man, hard luck to the ordinary citizens of Trinidad and Tobago. I heard the mumblings of some PNM supporters that mass people don't wait for Carnival to start them costumes. Them costumes put down already. Put down for what? Mass in Miami, mass in Barbados, mass in Atlanta, but not mass in Trinidad and Tobago. And costumes put down, you say? Put down with what financing? The entertainment industry was given a one-off grant. You believe that? A one-off grant in 2 years. A meager 5,000. And we know the cry with these grants. Half have not received it as yet. Yet they are funding a taste of Carnival while our entertainers are suffering. That is if they even got the grant. On January the 16th, Randy Glasgow, CEO of Randy Glasgow Productions, called the concept of a safe zone carnival a premature. Premature, he said, at best, and irresponsible. Ladies and gentlemen, everything the PNM government does is premature and irresponsible. All their policies and legislations are premature and irresponsible and not people-centered. The Ministry of Tourism, Culture and the Arts also had the audacity to say that they have yet to gauge the level of financial assistance that the National Carnival Commission and other stakeholders will be required to support. Ladies and gentlemen, I tell you, Carnival was not budgeted for. In other words, fellow supporters, there was no plan. Therefore, if you fail to plan, you plan to fail. Carnival 2022 was never budgeted for. The PNM needs to understand that you cannot bully your way to success or bully your way to completion of the highway, of Carnival, of the roadway, Murga Tablan. Just like they couldn't bully their way to win the Tobago elections, but they have not learned their lesson as yet. They continue to bully us, the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago. But just this morning, the chairman of NCC had the gall to tell the nation that maybe 25 to 30 million would be allocated for this not safe zone, but fake zone carnival. Where is the 30 million coming from, I ask you? And where it's going, that is the question. Whose pocket would it go into? And what about our health infrastructure and its capacity to handle the negative consequences of this outbreak while struggling to handle the current situation? Would any foreigners even come to Trinidad and Tobago for a taste of Carnival? What is the feasibility of producing and presenting events? What is the impact of the inflation rates And what is the vaccination status of members of the carnival industry? Another way to discriminate and another way to hinder our entertainers from making a dollar, the ones that really need it. This clueless government has to be told what needs urgent attention in our country. And that is why it is a good thing we have the Honorable Kamala Prasad Bisesa to hold them accountable, to point out their wrongdoings, and to tell them what is important to us, the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago. Like right now, we need social assistance for the vulnerable in our societies. We need to hear the cry of single mothers who cannot afford to buy milk for their children. We need jobs for the unemployed, for our young graduates. We need more jobs. OJT is not sufficient. Yes, we are thankful for the placements, but they cannot suffice what is going on with the unemployment rate. Salary negotiations, not just an announcement by the Minister of Finance, but we really need negotiations that deal with salaries that would give people a chance to survive in these current economic times. We need payment of our back pay and gratuities, especially the gratuities of those who have recently lost their jobs. I remember some time back, the Prime Minister, "I don't like my money to sleep out. Why must persons wait for their gratuities? The normal man don't like his money to sleep out. In this current economic time, we cannot afford for our money to sleep out. We need our money. People have bills to pay, rent to pay. While Faris is a landlord, could hold strain. You're telling the small man to hold strain. How much strain can the small man hold again? And with active COVID-19 cases at approximately 20,000, and the Ministry of Health telling us about the Omicron variant, what are we really doing? And so I ask the question, who will benefit from this safe zone carnival? I thank you, Trinidad and Tobago.
Everybody crying out for democracy. Now it's time to take a stand. Yeah.
Come on! Because this is the revolution. The people's revolution.
Thank you, MP Benjamin, for that dynamic delivery as usual. My next task is a simple one, because our next speaker needs no introduction. A name that has grown to become a common one amongst the political arena today. Barry has been at the forefront of representing the interests of Princess Tom. Working in the political sphere since his student days, Barry brings a mix of youth and experience to the parliament. Serving as the member for Princess Tom since 2015, Barry has contributed on numerous pieces of legislation and debated several motions. He continues to work with the members of council at the Princess Tom Regional Corporation to advocate for the delivery of goods and services to the people of Princess Tom. He represents with fire and conviction. MP Barry stands with Princess Tom, and the UNC stands with you. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for MP Barry Potterat.
Come on, people. Freedom. Come on, come on, come on, come on.
The People's Revolution.
Everybody say, as we move in this people's revolution, my brothers and sisters, let's all walk together as one.
Political leader of the United National Congress, the Honorable Kamala Prasad Bisesa, parliamentary colleagues, brothers and sisters of the United National Congress, Trinidad and Tobago. On January 24th, 2022, we as a party recognize the 12th anniversary of the Honorable Kamala Prasad Bisesa as our political leader. Over the course of those 12 years of service, we provided this country with the best prime minister and the first woman to become prime minister of our country. We saw the construction and unprecedented development of schools, hospitals, bridges, highways, roads, and much, much more. Lest we forget, it was her leadership that birthed the Children's Life Fund, the Laptop Initiative, and the world ranking of the best place for a girl child to be born. by the World Economic Forum. It was under Kamla Prasad Bisesa's prime ministership that our economy flourished, with foreign direct investment peaking at $48 billion in 2014. Apart from her sterling contribution as prime minister, tonight I want to ask, would this country have been aware of the $1 billion fake oil scandal had opposition leader Kamla Prasad Bisesa not exposed it? Would this country have known that a high-ranking government official intercepted the top COP order of merit list surreptitiously from the clutches of the president? Would we have known as a country if it was not for Kamla Prasad Bisesa that Delcy Rodriguez came into this country with officials of PDVSA on a sanctioned aircraft? There is so much to ask tonight. But tonight, I want to deal frankly and brutally with another matter that Kamla Prasad Bisesa exposed in 2018 in the Parliament of Trinidad and Tobago. Please play the video.
Opposition leader Kamla Prasad Bisesa has accused the government of being secretive regarding the share agreement for the purchase by TSTT of 100% shares of Massey Communications for $255 million. Mrs. Prasad Bisesa was speaking in the House of Representatives today during the debate. Sharon Lewis has more.
Last week, majority state-owned company TSTT announced a share purchase agreement with the value of the impending sale and $255 million. This the opposition leader is calling deceptive, saying the Prime Minister and the Line Minister knew about the SPA all along.
And in this very parliament, we cannot get one minister saying the same thing as the other. Yeah. It is as though the Honourable Minister of Finance, it is as though that no one has any confidence in the Honourable Minister, when as corporation sole, he could tell this country that he knew nothing about a massive nothing. And the line minister in this house, I have the Hansard, tells this parliament not once, not twice, but more than three times, yes. The cabinet did not know about Massey.
Mrs. Prasad Bisesa believes that there was no transparency in this merger and is calling on the government to come clean with the facts.
So do I believe the Honourable Minister of Finance? Do I believe the Honourable Minister for Public Utilities, the line minister? I think the Minister for Port of Spain, North and West, the Minister in the Ministry of the Office of the Prime Minister, because all the reports coming through in the last week or two from these ministers is the cabinet knew nothing. Why do I raise this? I raise this in the context of good, honest, equitable, transparent money.
On Tuesday, the unions representing workers at TSTT, which we are on the eve of today being Monday, have been summoned to a meeting at 9 a.m. All unions have been invited to what we know is not a consultation on the restructuring of TSTT, but the death announcement of over 700 workers from the organization. TSTT currently has a complement of 1,000 workers. When Kamla Prasad Bisesa left as Prime Minister, TSTT had a complement of over 3,000 workers. Under Rowley's watch, there's now a complement of 1,000 workers. With the much anticipated announcements coming, not consultation, announcements coming to the unions tomorrow, it is anticipated that over 700 workers will go home, all, in an effort to privatize TSTT and further sell out to friends and financiers of the PNM. In 2018, when government bought Massey Communication for over $279 million, government remained silent, and you saw a political leader standing her ground in the parliament, questioning the prime minister, questioning the minister of finance as it relates to the acquisition of Massey Communications at a tune of $279 million under secret circumstances. Confusion between ministers. No one knew about this acquisition, we were told. Our leader has been telling us, what is in the dark will come to the light.
with the impending retrenchment of workers come Tuesday, I have several questions I want to ask this evening. You see, some documents have found its way into my mailbox. And the very first question that I want to ask was whether TSTT breached their contract with Amplia prior to the buying out of Massey Communications with a company called Fujitsu. Second question, was a storm in a teacup situation created for now CEO Lisa Agard of TSTT, who was then a director at Massey Communication, to threaten legal action against TSTT? Documents in my mailbox suggest, and it might very well reveal, the circumstances and the reasons why Massey Communication was bought by the government so secretively, as asked by our political leader since 2018 in the Parliament of Trinidad and Tobago. Based on these documents, I want to ask whether TSTT, prior to the purchase of Massey Communications, had a contract with Amplia for a program called Oracle. Was TSCT's hand forced to purchase Massey Communications, who had less than 5,000 customers, no profits registered, and is currently, at that time, on its deathbed to avoid litigation? Fifth question. Are the same players involved in this matter now at senior management levels at TSCT to demonize TSCT employees? Is this an effort to drive TSCT into the ground and transfer assets to Amplia? Was this the perfect storm where government created a situation, took a hands-off approach, and pushed agents of the PNM to do their bidding? This is the same playbook as Petrotrin. Brothers and sisters, when Petrotrin was closed down and Heritage was opened up, now we are seeing where efforts are being made for TSCT to be closed down and transfer everything to Amplia. Is this the real reason why four directors up to January 18th resigned from the board? Is this why Emil Elias resigned as chairman of TSCT? Those were the questions that were asked in the parliament since 2018 by Kamla Prasad Bisesa. Today, as Mrs. Prasad Bisesa tells us, what is in the dark will come to the light. Brothers and sisters, on the eve of the major announcements by TSCT, I want to deal with another matter that has TSCT in the situation that it is facing today. I refer to an article, Thursday, January 17, 2019, headline, 500 million TSCT deal gone sour, 40,300 phones idle in Miami warehouse. Brothers and sisters, this deal, this sour deal, has indicated by Renuka Singh on January 17, 2019. The article says this. This is the second contract queried in the internal audit, which Guardian Media received a copy, along with a tick file of other documents from a whistleblower seeking to expose alleged financial mismanagement at the company. $500 million, Faris Alrawi, come Friday when you bring that whistleblower legislation to the parliament, you must tell us, when Kamla Prasad Bisesa called you out in 2018, why is whistleblower legislation for $500 million now coming to the parliament? I further want to ask, in this article it said, Guardian Media learned that part of the agreement was the supply of 56,300 mobile phones valued at US$84.1 million. That's US, not TT. However, the absence of a formal agreement left CT Miami holding some 40,300 phones valued at $29 million for TSCT. Tonight, I want to ask, because if government cannot say, the documents that have found its way to the opposition will find its way to the authorities. Who is blocking the whistle blowing for who? Which government official is in the middle of this matter? Which government official met with executives in Miami to broker this deal? Whistleblower legislation, come Friday in the parliament, we will have some issues to deal with frontally. The assets of TSCT will come into play tomorrow when the unions are addressed by management. This is no mama guy of consultation. They are being called in, summoned to be told what will be their fate, what will be their future, all going. Brothers and sisters, I have some documents that I want to share with you. So, like Petrotrin, the attempt to demonize the workers at TSCT will come into play tomorrow and over the course of the next few weeks. But we must understand, like Petrotrin, Petrotrin registered a profit in 2014, up to the time Kamala Pisabi-Sessa left as prime minister. Petrotrin was making a profit on the books. Post Prime Minister Kamala Pisabi-Sessa, what did we see? We saw year after year after year, Petrotrin going down and down and down until they were in the red. The same playbook is happening at WASA, which I will deal with on another occasion. You see that WASA subcommittee report will find its way very soon in the public domain. But that entire situation at WASA was created to deal with a fellow called Watson Duke. But instead of dealing with Watson Duke dealt with the PNM. But let us get back on track. TSCT. How did TSCT arrive at the situation it's in? And on the eve of over 700 workers to go home, how did they arrive at that situation? They will have the population believe that because of the environment, the technological environment right now with WhatsApp calls and connectivity, that is the reason why TSCT is losing money. I just told you, $500 million, half a billion dollars down the drain. Who was the top government official that ran up the road to Miami to broker that deal when there were no arrangements that were put in place by TSCT to have those contracts signed? Faris Al-Rawi, come on Friday. That information that was provided by the whistleblower, I hope you can tell that to Trinidad and Tobago, how you intend on getting back that $500 million under your watch as Attorney General, under the watch of Prime Minister Keith Rowley, who today throws up their hand in the air and says, just like in 2018 when Mrs. Pisabi-Sessa asked, they said government had no knowledge of this. Today we are saying to you that we have the information and you can run, but you cannot hide. The other matter that we will deal with tonight has to do with the assets of TSCT. I have a few photographs that I want to share because one of these properties resides a stone's throw away from my constituency office. Property one. Property two, property three, property four, property five. Lavantil Work Center, Sepero Street Work Center, Port of Spain Work Center, property in Matilda, property in San Fernando. All owned by TSCT, the assets of the people of Trinidad and Tobago. These are not the assets of any private organization. The patrimony of Trinidad and Tobago, the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago, lies in the ownership of TSCT. Brothers and sisters, these five properties have been vacant. They are for warehouse usage, they are for specialized usage. And I share those properties with you because another document has found itself in my mailbox. And this property has to do with a sole select. And sole select means that the management of TS City. And government will have us believe that what is happening at TS City, they have no knowledge of since 2018 and even before. But as I've said to you time and time again, the cabinet of Trinidad and Tobago, headed by the Prime Minister, the line minister for TS City is the Minister of Public Utilities, Marvin Gonzalez. They dictate the state enterprises and state companies when major decisions in terms of acquisitions, in terms of rentals, etc., are to be made. They are the ones who determine what is government policy. When the Prime Minister told us that the rich will get richer, while these five properties across Trinidad and Tobago remain vacant, the properties that are owned by the people of Trinidad and Tobago, the rich is getting richer based on these documents in this file. You see, there's a property in Dabadi that government, through TS City, has signed a contract for. They have spent $8.6 million to outfit only. Only to outfit. There is a lease agreement, I'm told, it is alleged, for over 15 years, with millions of dollars of Trinidad and Tobago taxpayers' money funding this, while properties across the length and breadth of Trinidad and Tobago remain vacant. When you look at the company's registry, I don't have the time to go through the names this evening, but this is the creme de la creme of the 1% of Trinidad and Tobago. When the Prime Minister told us the rich will get richer, he knew exactly what he was speaking about. So it is not the employees at TSCT that has us in the position that we are in today. It is not the people, according to Ms. John, in the Beetham and in Laventille, where those same properties reside, where they can be hiring Trinidad and Tobago citizens within these so-called hotspot and depressed areas to put them to work. You know, I heard the Minister of Public Utilities, Marvin Gonzalez, accusing the UNC of sabotaging their project in Beetham. I want to tell the PNM tonight, you should be ashamed to speak about the Beetham. You have kept the people of Beetham, who have voted nothing but the People's National Movement since prior to independence in this country, in bondage. You have sabotaged the people of Beetham and Laventille to the point where they continue to live in squalor and poverty, passing on from generation to generation. You know, I heard my colleague earlier, Michelle Benjamin, dealing with the issue of NCC's announcement this evening for Carnival. And we are being told in this pandemic that government has raided the Heritage and Stabilization Fund, billions of dollars. Ravi told us we cannot see where it's going. We are seeing the privatization of state companies, WASA, TNTech, Petrotrin, to the tune of billions of dollars, while the people of Trinidad and Tobago continue to suffer. Brothers and sisters, when Michelle told you that they announced it was $20 million, it's not $20 million, it's over $35 million jumping up. The only thing jumping up is not the people and the masqueraders. It's the money of the people of Trinidad and Tobago. And in local parlance, we say, you could have champagne taste or champagne money. But in this case, you have champagne taste, champagne money, and mobby taste. This is the scenario that we are seeing. This is exactly what is playing out. Over $35 million. But brothers and sisters, they are jamming still while the people of Trinidad and Tobago continue to suffer. While tomorrow we'll be paying close attention to what another state enterprise is being sabotaged at the hands of this government, we sound notice and warning to the people of Trinidad and Tobago to ensure that you stand up. You stand up with the United National Congress. You stand up with the Honorable Kamla Pisabi-Sessa, because we are the ones who will continue to expose the People's National Movement. And come Friday, with that whistleblower legislation to the Parliament, you better come good. because we will be walking with a whistle, and we will see who will blow the whistle on who. Brothers and sisters, I thank you, and it's very interesting times ahead. But surely, as night follows years, as Ravi told you, the sun will rise again, and the Honorable Kamala Prasad Bisesa will continue, and we will continue to stand with her on the side of the people of Trinidad and Tobago. I thank you.
Right now, from the leadership of the United National Congress, the first woman Prime Minister, the first woman Attorney General, the first woman to lead a parliamentary political party, the first woman opposition leader, let's welcome Kamala Prasad Bisesa, Senior Counsel.
Good evening, everyone. Those who are with us here in this room and those are locked on, wherever you are, thank you for joining us for another virtual report. And tonight, I have been very impressed with our speakers. Give them a round of applause. Sean Sobers, Michelle Benjamin, Ravi Ratiram, and the Peppermouth himself, Barry Padarat. So give them a round of applause. And let us also thank our counselors who have been hosting these proceedings. Rishi Balram Singh and Councillor Shanti Budram. I know they've been working very hard recently. We have a by-election coming up on Monday next, and followed upon the defeat of Rowley and the PNM in Tobago. Rowley lose again on Monday the 7th in Davis South. So we can feel the passion and the commitment and the energy and the dynamism of the UNC. With each day, we become stronger and stronger. And why? Because you are out there standing with us. Tonight, I commit again, we will stand with you. We will stay with you, and we will fight with you and for you until this wicked, Rowley government is gone. I have several matters to report on, and let's see how much we can get done tonight, because we will talk with you again. I want to talk about people-centered government. I want to talk a little about the hidden mental health problems people are facing in the pandemic. I want to talk about remembering dearly departed soul Andrea Barrett 1 year later. I want to talk about the compromising of the new police service commission. I want to talk about the what Ravi is calling the mosquito crack, the mashup creek down the road. I want to talk about the PNM party group calling itself a transparency institute. And then we have to talk about the NIB and the failures of the government with respect to the NIB. The failure of the government with respect to the laying of the EBC report, the latest report that will trigger in and command and take over the local government elections which are due this year. Why are you hiding that report? Why don't you lay the report? We have been told that report reached to the government since June 2021. So many months have passed, but it's an important report because it will tell us about the boundaries. But it is that you want to spring a surprise on us and all other parties because you have knowledge of the changes in the boundaries and you will bring it just on the eve of the local. But no way. We come in for you and we are coming for that report. I'd intended to speak a little about TSTT, but I think Ravi has done a tremendous job. So I will rest and endorse the matters raised by MP Ratiram. Ratiram. Well, both MPs, of course, and Michelle. And Michelle talked to us about Carnival, you know, and I was making a note while she was speaking. I want to know, this $30 million that they're going to spend on Carnival, who will benefit? Michelle raised it. So I want to ask the chairman of the North Central Regional Health Authority, Davlin Thomas, who also is the deputy chair of NCC. And the question is, how many of these safe zone, so-called fake zone events will put money in the pocket of Davlin Thomas? Is a very important question. So keep tuned, let us see what are the events they'll be hosting, and let us see what input this carnival man from the NCC will have into that. I am seeing, well, who getting it? I'm saying Davlin Thomas may well be one of them. And who else will benefit from this $30 million? Because I saw somebody put up on the Facebook today some isolating little boots. Are they what? Well, that's it. Well, you know already. You see the goat pens they have put up. We know the man is a goat man, but oh God, for carnival too. Are you real? Are you real, Mr. Rowley? So let's keep our eyes on that carnival because it's very close to us. Michelle has prosecuted that matter very well tonight. So these are some of the areas. Let me talk first about people-centered government. When we were in government, you could have seen, you could feel, you could touch, you could taste, you would have seen development across the length and breadth of Trinidad and Tobago. From Cedras way down in the south, all the way across the water to Charlottesville. From Separia to Scarborough. The length and breadth we had development, schools, roads, highways, health centers, hospitals. You could see it, you could feel it, you could taste it. But under this government, all we are seeing is destruction. All across the land, destruction. The latest being, we saw the Mosquito Creek collapsing. So new schools, that's the kind of government we stand for, I stood for, the UNC stands for. It's people-centered government. People-centered government. Our great party will never stop fighting for every one of you. And we look forward again to what we always use to guide us, to serve the people, serve the people, serve the people. Instead, what we see here is everything is collapsing. I'm going to call a list, and as I say, blow the whistle. If you believe it, you may add to this list. Everything is collapsing. The HEC Las Alturas project built under Rowley collapsed. Foreign election observers collapsed. Emailgate collapsed. Free laptops collapsed. Sandals in Tobago collapsed. The Public Procurement Act passed, collapsed. Petrotrin, Petrotrin GTL plant collapsed. 100 million fake oil collapsed. ArcelorMittal collapsed. Train 1 Atlantic LNG collapsed. And the list doesn't end there. The methanol ammonia plants collapsed. Rock hard cement collapsed. Foreign direct investment collapsed. Forex availability collapsed. An acceptable debt to GDP ratio, last week I shared those numbers of debt into the valley of debt, collapsed. Agricultural sustainability collapsed. The Police Service Commission last year collapsed, and this one is on its way to collapsing as well, the new one. The Top Cop Merit List 2021 collapsed. I think Paula collapsed too, if I'm not mistaken, and I'll deal with her again tonight. The Central Block Project collapsed. Mosquito Creek Roadway collapsed. And don't forget Humpty Dumpty collapsed in my constituency. Coming to open a fire station that the UNC built. Humpty Dumpty fell off the wall, Stuarty. I felt so sorry for you that day. I really felt sorry. And then, of course, even the THA-PNM collapsed, but we welcome that collapse. So we see the glaring failures and the destruction of our country under this clueless and very corrupt Rowley administration. And now, whilst they are collapsing, going from pre-collapse with the Tobago election to collapse there, building nothing, doing nothing. What's our job? What is our job as a loyal, responsible opposition of this country? Some people don't seem to understand that an opposition is vital to democracy. And it is our job to hold the government to account. Several examples have been given. We've done it time and again as we report to you in these meetings and elsewhere. on the virtual, on the press briefings, in the parliament, outside the parliament, we must hold this wicked, corrupt government to account every single day. That is my job. And I am not giving up that job as we speak. I am not giving it up. That is my job. That is the job of the UNC in the parliament and outside the parliament. So whilst they're collapsing, as I say, our job is to ensure that our country does not collapse. It's to ensure that our democracy does not collapse. That's their plan. Their plan is to kill any peaceful protest, anyone stand up. Well, tomorrow you're going to get some people walking down that Mosquito Creek in protest. And don't come to blame Kamala. You know, some people, I told you all last week, they say I'm sending mangrove crab down there to eat away whatever piece of road is left. Well, I have no control of mangrove crabs, but I do have control of the UNC. We will stand with you. We will fight with you. And we'll fight for you. And that is what I promise. We will not give up until this government is gone from office. I said, looking at all the collapsing going on around us, I have seen such warmth and love. I walked this weekend in the Davis South area, walking there with the candidate and other activists. They have a great team there by the day. They're working very hard. And I saw that outpouring of love, and I was inspired to continue to work harder and harder. And I'm sure you will be too when you join them there and elsewhere. But you know, I saw this woman, I'm sorry, this lady, woman, we are same thing, Penny Beckles, walking in a Rima. Did you all see it? Do you have the video, anybody? Pictures up, look. Keep showing it, one whole bus of police. A busload, a police bus for this lady to walk in a Rima, man. And crime is totally out of control in the country. But you want to walk behind Penny with a busload of police? You want to put police, I'm told, on the creek, you put up line of police looking for the mangrove crab that the UNC sent in. When you have bandits in this country, at length across the land, that is what is happening. How do you deploy the police? You know, I feel sorry for Jacob. I know some people want to blame Jacob. But man, if you had a boss, your line minister is Fitzy. I feel sorry for you. That is real, real stress. That is total stress, Mr. Jacob. I feel sorry for you. So while crime is out of control, you're putting police down on the creek. A whole line. I saw the pictures. You have our police bus following this MP. And by the way, Minister Stiotti, do you still have anything to do with the blue lights that you drive around with? You are no longer Minister of National Security. Why you have police blue lights following you everywhere you go in? I don't want to know where you're going. I think a lot of people know where, but I don't want to know. But you should not be having police blue lights following you everywhere. We have enough crime in the country. Deploy the police to do the police job, to protect and serve. Protect and serve. Why? Why are you special out of all the ministers? Why are you a special one that you must have blue lights and police following you everywhere you go? And so before I go into other issues, let's talk a little about this hidden aspect of the pandemic. It is real. The PNM's deadly mismanagement. That is a toll that is taking place on the mental health of our young ones, our children, students, and the not so young ones. My heart goes out to all these families. All those are dealing with the mental toll that these difficult times have placed upon us. Seeing death all around, not being able to grieve properly and remedy, it stopped you from even some parts of the communities from being able to do their proper religious rituals, to perform those rituals, the cremations and so on, that are necessary to help bring closure. Not being able to have proper human contact for so long, even though so much of the world elsewhere is opening up, that mental toll taking place here. And then they go from left to right. It's vaps and whoops that they operate on. One day they're doing X, the next day they're doing Y. The next day they're going back to P and Q. They're never on a straight line. They're not consistent in their policies, in their programs for the betterment of Trinidad and Tobago. It's one step forward, one back. And then it's left foot, right foot, Bali Jesus everywhere. So here we are. Without that human touch, minds can go into darkness. We need to remember there are many of our neighbors, many of our friends who are all fighting personal battles we know nothing about. Being closed up without proper human interaction only makes it worse. Please remember, I ask you to show compassion and kindness to everyone around you in these very trying times. And I want to give you a commitment that the UNC government will take all the steps necessary to help those who are in mental distress. What is this government doing about those people? They are doing nothing and causing it too, because, as I said, flip-flop on their policies. There's people struggling to pay bills, people struggling to find work, people struggling to feed families. And you spending $30 million to put money in whose pocket for a fake zone carnival. I take great umbrage. I know we are proud of our carnival. I don't care what anybody says, I'm very proud. That is one of the greatest shows on earth, as Michelle has been telling us. You're spending the $30 million, but where's that money going? Today, someone from my constituency called to tell us they run a small business, and half of their employees, they had to shut down. Half got the salary grant, and the other half did not get. I wonder why is that? What criteria was used to discriminate against persons? And they asked me to raise it. I will raise it and put it pen to paper legally to see how we can help them. So you have all this stress out there. And there's a taboo of discussing mental health. Isn't that true? People don't like to talk about it. You hide it in the dark. We have to find a way in this epidemic of mental illness and pandemic mental distress. I'm sure many of you listening now may be feeling these strains. We cannot bury our heads in the sand. We must help each other. And again, I say, when, not if, you know, when the UNC forms the next government, we'll make dealing with mental health issues a component of pandemic recovery. Rowley, if you care, call it now. You can do it now. You can do it now. As I always say, the economy is not just about numbers on a pie chart. The economy is about people. We cannot improve the health of our economy without improving the health of our people. They are one and the same. The guiding principles, you know, of the UNC is and forever will be putting people first. Putting people first. Not the dollars. Not the $23 million. Not the 8 million Barry spoke about. Not all those millions. It's not about that. It's not a number. It's about people. I turn now to remarking upon and remembering Andrea Barrett, late Andrea Barrett, 1 year later. You all remember that time? It was around the same time where Marsha Riley, remember her too? So many of our young women being struck down and murdered in the most brutal way. And then you have this crocodile tears man, Forrest, crying somewhere in some vigil somewhere, promising pepper spray. Today I ask you, Forrest, where is the pepper spray legislation implementation? You went up and down the country, you give the woman a give, but you see, you don't care because your children have high-powered rifles. You have police blue lights driving around you. Privileged, as I'm Sean told us. Privileged PNM. And what about the rest of the country? That is a kind of, you know, Shradabi says a 71 that we talk about, huh? So when the Andrea Barrett issue was really gripping the nation in grief, yes, Farris jumped on the bandwagon, crocodile tears, mama guy, and all those things. That is the kind of pattern about the PNM. Because they're allowed to get away with all kinds of corruption, all kinds of misdeeds, all sorts of costly mistakes and errors without having to pay for it. They just have to hold out for a 7-day wonder, a 9-day wonder, and they believe they can get away with it. But we are not going to let them get away with that anymore. We will not. We will remember, and we will not let them or the country forget. We will hold them accountable. So for instance, last week, as I say, 1 year since that horrific murder, two murders, two young women, shocked the nation. Now 1 year later, after all these vigils for young Andrea, for young Miss Riley, Marsha Riley. Sorry. For young Miss Riley, we still cannot get the promised pepper spray. You know, I think we passed it in the parliament, you know. But they don't implement. Last week, Ravi mentioned tonight, NATO, no action talk only. That's all they do. They come out busy, 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 busy. Busy, busy, like crazy crab. All over the place. Yes, pepper spray, pepper spray. Then you say the UNC don't want it. Lie. We have been calling for pepper spray legislation, Kirk, remember, since 2017. 2017, we are in 2022, and all the crocodile tears by Farris and all the others. Just empty words. Women are no safer today than they were then. Things are definitely worse. Almost 1 year to the day, Andrea Barrett's body was found down that precipice, man. That could be any one of our children, Farris. You have young children too. Why don't you implement the pepper spray legislation? What is holding it back? What is so difficult? Is it that you're waiting for someone of your family members or your friends to set up a pepper spray factory or something? Is that what it is? Because what I'm told is you have to do regulations to give the quantities and whatever the chemicals and whatever else. So like the cannabis bill, remember, they're waiting to implement that too. Remember, some relative of someone had some company already registered before that law even became into the books. So is it that? No, that fellow will not recuse himself in the parliament. You saw what happened last week. He said, yes, I have an interest, but there's no conflict. Yes, I have an interest. One of the buildings, yes. My family has that. We making rent from that. Another building, by the way. That man has about 5 properties, you know, rented to the government. Shame. Without shame. Will come to the parliament and will not recuse himself. But then he says, in the cabinet, he recuses. The whole thing's a puppy show. I've said it is a business. They're running the cabinet of the government of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago as a business enterprise. And today you would have read the brother-in-law of a senior minister, the same rental man, what kind of contracts he was getting in the TTPS. Yesterday, I think it was, yesterday's. Brother-in-law now, we'll not call his name, everybody knows who he is. And he's getting all these contracts, which he didn't get before. He was not on the list, you know, they have a list of contractors to provide goods and services. So that other family member is benefiting. So how it is, Farris Rowley, do your part now. What is so hard to implement this law? You may see the writing on the wall that soon it'll be time for you to go, but while you are there, protect our women. Bring on the pepper spray legislation fully into force. Bring it on now. And if that fitzy fella can't do the job, get rid of him. Get him out. As Minister of National Security, that legislation is on the... Get him out of office for that and many other reasons. Many, many other reasons. There's so much bloodshed under this PNM. So much bloodshed. I think we now have over 48 murders in the space of 30 days. 1 month ended today. 48 and more and counting each day. So it's not only the lives of young women at stake. It is everyone, the old, the young, men, women, or children. If your pet's not safe under this PNM, I think Fitzy bounced on somebody's dog recently. Even the pet's not safe under Fitzy Ethelbert Hines. Last week, there was a horrific killing right here in the Southland at South Park Mall. It was frightening, worrying development, with criminals becoming more brazen in broad daylight, as we say, going in anywhere, anytime, automatic gunfire in the midst of a shopping area with hundreds of citizens. You have to wonder whether this is somewhere in the Middle East, in Syria, or some other war zone, or is this Trinidad and Tobago? What are those in charge saying? Can I say something here, you know? With all this gunfire taking place all over the country, this government is spending money and valuable time tracking down who got legal firearms. Have they spent 1 cent and 1 second to find out where all these illegal guns are coming, how they're getting in, how they're crossing the border? Fitzy, tell us who is bringing it and why. You're so busy running down a man with a licensed firearm, but nothing is being done or said about the unlicensed illegal ones. But then again, as I say, you're all happy. You have children with high-powered rifles and blue lights following you wherever you go. You have no concern for the rest of the country. Well, and the busload of police, yes, thank you for reminding me, MP. The busload in Arima and the little battalion down on the creek. And bandits all over shooting up the place like the Wild Wild West. And when that happened, did you hear a word from Keith Rowley? In fact, I saw him on the front page today. I think he was playing golf somewhere. Golfing, his priority is golfing. Not a word when these murders are taking place. He's still silent after he mashed up the whole police service commission. and the leadership of the TTPS with it. And we see him, as I say, playing golf somewhere. I don't know where. Is it Tobago or Trinidad? St. Anne's. Well, there's a place close by, you know. I think he may need to pay a visit to that other St. Anne's institution. I think he needs to, because where's your heart? Where's your care? Where's your compassion, man? Go and get some. Maybe visit that place. See if they can help you. Not a word from him. And what about the Minister of National Insecurity? The fellow Fitzy Ethelbert Hines, did he make a statement about this gangland killing? He only seems to wake up. You know what he does? He goes on, these people live on the Facebook, you know, or the WhatsApp or whatever. That fellow will wake up any hour of the day or night and post the most vile kind of comments. Vile! But wouldn't find a moment to talk about something so serious, to tell us what are the plans. What do you intend to do? Murder's now 48 and climbing. What are your plans? That's what I told you all earlier. I feel sorry for Jacob to have to work under Fitzy. Nothing. He said nothing. He write these abusive posts. And he has constituents living in raw sewage. And then they want to blame UNC and me. Man, Barry, I think you dealt with them well. The answer is, there was not a word from these senior people. Nothing, nothing, nothing. And if they say nothing, well, imagine they're doing even less than nothing. Darren gave me a little joke here he wanted me to share with you. It says, a man came to his office one morning and his co-worker told him, today I'm just going to do nothing. His colleague said, but you did nothing yesterday. The man answered, yeah, I know, but I haven't finished yet. I think this is Fitzy, doing nothing, saying nothing, and he still hasn't finished nothing. They are jokers. Does nothing, can't even finish doing nothing. Running our country. How on earth could such a brutal killing take place in our nation? Not a peep from any one of them. I call on the country to make your voices heard and demand that Rowley replace Hines with a competent Minister of National Security. Yeah. Hines must go now. He must go now. This is not a joke. National security is a serious issue, and Hines is totally, totally, totally incompetent. This is like over 3,300 COVID deaths. Yes, we know about that. But look at the murders. So you have the pandemic of the COVID, and we have the pandemic of crime and criminality in our country, and nothing is being done usefully about both of them. The committee that was supposed to report, remember the seven-day committee? I told you all right here. That thing will never finish in 7 days. And then they came and they want more time, and they went more, and nobody's saying anything. It was only on the last Monday when I called them out, then their people remembered. Well, wait, now 7 days gone. Then they came and made a statement after the people asked for more time. Well, you knew that from the beginning. You came to mama guide the country, you're doing something when whatever you come up with is so foolish, cannot be done. It's only when we reminded them, the Alsing run out to say, hey, okay, we're giving them the one more time. They asked for more time. Well, let's see when that time expires, if they'll still be asking for more time. So that's what I said from the beginning. We said they would never be able to report in 7 days. Never. Nobody else challenged or questioned the Prime Minister, you know. I don't understand what's happening in this country. Is it that everybody's afraid of Rowley and his government, that they will not ask questions, they will not call them out? Not even the committee said they would need more time. Everybody was going along with the mama guy. Except for us, we will not let them get away. Government doesn't care about your life. Whether it's death from crime, death from COVID, or whether it's about helping to protect yourself with that pepper spray. They just do not care. Keep on golfing, Rowley. Keep on the golfing. Your days are numbered politically. Your political days are numbered. We will work until we get you and your government out of office. You know, when they pass the big piece of anti-gang legislation, the UNC don't want to support it. We don't want to support it. Why? UNC have friends in gangs. They always make these spurious, baseless allegations. Okay, okay, we support them. We put it on the statute books. Everybody started to attack me. Today, those same people are deathly silent when you're having all these gangland murders going on. Gang murders, gang-related murders. Not a word do they have to say. Why again? They said they knew who the gangs were. They knew the number of gangs. Farris said he knew where to find them. Blah, 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 blah. Pass the law, and what happened? Nothing again. They missed nothing himself. Nothing. Farrisser, they knew all the gang members. They were waiting on us to pass the bill. What happened, Farris? Where are these gangsters you promised to lock up? Now gangland murders taking place. While people are shopping in stores, gangs are killing people in the car park. Not a word from the authorities. You know, I read a story in the newspapers about the murder of a 96-year-old woman. 96 years, huh? Her name is Utilda Joseph, and she's from Separia. The report was carried in the newspapers. Last year in April, Utilda was brutally murdered during a home invasion. Home invasion. This one has nothing to do with gang and gang and gang. This is an elderly woman in a home where bandits invaded her home and murdered her. 1 year later, not a single person, not a single person has been held accountable and arrested. I read how she was so popular in a church, how she gave so much back to her community. Utilda was a caregiver to so many young people in her neighborhood. And yet 1 year after her murder, her loved ones are yet to get justice for her. We know that the basic function of any government is to keep its citizens safe. That is why everywhere in the Commonwealth, the 52 member nations of the Commonwealth under which we model our jurisprudence and our law, everywhere around the world, national security is not privatized. This is in the common law jurisdictions, not privatized, because there's a reason. You cannot have national security, police, army, and so on in private hands, under the watch of private individuals, because then they'll be looking for you or me or any one of us. They have a vendetta against, they have anything against. You're putting the greatest job of a government, which is national security, you have to keep it in an independent state. But then this government is so smart with foolishness that they're not privatizing it out by saying, let you run it or you run it. Instead, they're planting their people in the highest echelons of the independent offices that are the persons who select the leadership of the TTPS. So you remember that with that police service commission, how it collapsed last year. The new normal for the PNM wants us to accept everything. And now death is all around us. And let me talk about that new police service commission, because what have they done? The new police service commission now, you collapsed the last one. You interfered in the legal, independent process. Up to today, that elephant remains in the room and no one will talk about it. Who was the high official who blocked the list from coming to Parliament, who went by Paula and take the list away and tell her, don't send it to the Parliament, collapse that list, collapse the Police Service Commission, and not a word up to today. Who was that senior official? I ask again, Prime Minister Rowley, was it you? Were you the one who interfered in a process that is bedded in law, is guided by law? You interfered and breached the sanctity of a constitutional process. Now, this new police service commission has been appointed by that PNM puppet, President Paula Mayweeks. It gives me no joy to speak like this, but I have seen it over and over and over again. That president seems to be following the script of the old police service commission. Recall I told you, and I told the president, that she had no moral authority to appoint anyone to a new service commission unless she comes clean about the withdrawal of that 21 list last year, the withdrawal of the merit list. But she never did. Without any sense of shame or decency. Of course, she likes to lecture everybody. Yeah? I mean, she's a good lecturer, if anyone actually listens. No decency. The president proceeded to appoint this new commission. You know, I think sometimes the president believes that she can fool the rest of the population. But don't ever believe the UNC can't see that you are a PNM puppet, madam. You are a PNM puppet. Did the president get a job because she's a friend of the spouse of a senior government official? Did you know that? She's a friend. They have a ladies' club going on in this thing, you know. So she's a friend of a senior official, spouse, the wife of a senior official in this government. They're also liming buddies with one of the independent senators. Now, the president appoints people on that service commission who are also friends of herself and the spouse of this high government official. This is a PNM girls' club party group that the president appears to be running. So they handpick their friends to sit in key positions. This eater food behavior is what has also made the independent bench into a PNM bench in Parliament. This is the absolute worst and shameless independent bunch of senators in the history of Trinidad and Tobago. They have disgraced and debased the status of the independent bench. In all my years and the long, long years I have been in the politics of this country, I have never once spoken out against independent centers, but now water is more than flour. And we must speak, and we will speak. You are not doing your jobs because there's friends and family being picked to say that they are so-called independent centers. We will call you out. Anyways, this new commission must now answer how, very important, huh? How did government officials and the media get the Stanley John report? Blasted all over the front pages and of the newspapers. And we are told Rowley and the Security Council got it. How? You are an independent institution. How did this report find its way in the newspapers? Leaked. Who leaked it? Why? And why did you send it to Rowley? You are not to answer to Rowley. You are to answer to the people of Trinidad and Tobago. So how did this reach there? I am not talking about the contents of the report. You know, what I'm concerned about is how, why, when, where. A report commissioned by the independent, supposedly independent police service commission found its way in the media, found its way to the prime minister. How did that happen? Who did it? Are you all not supposed to be an independent commission? You must answer who gave instructions to send the report to the government. Through this act, you have severely compromised your perceived independence. And so now I ask, you must provide this information as well as a legal advice relating to the scrapping of the 2021 merit list. Why did you scrap that list? Was it a lawyer who told you to do it, or was it some high government official? You must answer that question. You must answer who leaked this information to the government and to the media. And if you can't do that, then you should just resign and go because you're totally compromised. What trust and confidence can we have in you to select the top officials of the TTPS? What instructions would you be given and by whom? And now even those new members, I said, that's why I said without decency the president appointed these members. You remember, some members of this new commission should not even be there because they were shown to be unfit for office from the get-go, from the very beginning. One is closely connected to the Prime Minister's best friend in Tobago, Mr. Warner, and that whole Inez Gate fiasco. Another of those persons was campaigning for the PNM in the general elections, making really abusive remarks about the UNC. Openly campaigning, go up on the Facebook, it's there. I think JJ should be some of them. Another one. And there's a third one. I'm told he has some serious behavioral allegations. Serious behavioral allegations. Some of it I think Dr. Munir had raised in the parliament. None of these people should be sitting there. They should have never been selected in the first place. And this is where, again, Her Excellency the President scraped the bottom of the barrel to come up with these people. I call on this commission to complain. I said it before, or resign. You all have already made a compromising mess of your appointments. I can't see that you can get any better. The only place you have to go further is to go down, down. And therefore, get out. Get out before you're used as puppets on a string by this wicked and corrupt government to do their bidding. That's what they're planning to do with you now. Imagine Faris brings another order to Parliament last Friday to how to select a commissioner of police and acting commissioner of police and deputy commissioner of police and acting deputies. A very serious piece of legislation because the court had struck down the previous one he brought in June last year, 2021, the court struck down that order. So he brought these two new orders and an Aprimer MP, Rodney Charles, applied in our house to have it annulled so we could debate the issues, and Senator Mark raised it in the Senate to have it annulled. And in our house, they put a fellow named Foster Cummins to speak. Throughout his speech in the parliament, he was shut down repeatedly because it's totally irrelevant to dealing with the order that was before the house. The government did not put anybody else to speak on such an important order. Because why? They could not answer the questions raised by the opposition in the parliament. And those questions had to do, why have you removed seniority as a criteria for recruiting a police commissioner or deputy commissioner or those like, why? In other jurisdictions, again, people work, you work on seniority, you gain experience, you want to head up at the top of the pile. I think every one of you here wishing and hoping one day you could take my job. That is what ambition is about, that you aspire upwards. And so those in the police service will be totally demoralized because now you're not going to be assessed because of seniority. How that can be right, I don't know. So today, tomorrow, you can take a junior officer and put them to act as commissioner of police. You can take a junior officer, put them to act as deputy commissioner of police for tomorrow. And then the next day, you move them out because they stopped acting and somebody else comes. So this junior person would be instructing senior officers. Senior officers, if you put them to act, why have you removed? It doesn't have to be the only criteria, but it should have been one important criteria removed. And that brings us to the question, well, whom do you have in mind? Who is the dark horse in the race that you're protecting? Which person you want your handpicked person to end up there who doesn't have the seniority? So you remove that as one of the criteria. Who is it? Maybe it's one of them on the bus, he's telling me, when Penny went up to Arima. So they have somebody in mind. I mean, why would you remove that? It's been there all the time. I was part of the team in 2009 with Mr. Manning, when Mr. Manning was prime minister, so when a lot of law changed about the police service commissioners, about the appointments of commissioner and deputy commissioners and so on, all of that was changed in that period, 2009. And seniority has always been one of the criteria for picking the top cop and the deputy top cop. So we watch that as well. Again, they are about licking up independent institutions, putting their own people into place, but none of that going to help them. Because they did it in Tobago and they got greenwashed out in Tobago. Got totally greenwashed out. And in Mosquito Creek, we talk so much about it, so I think I can rest my case on that. And just give you the assurance, I said no mangrove crabs down to the creek to do anything. And let's look at Transparency Institute. They came out recently, a few days ago, to say we had climbed one in the rank, from 40 to 41. Oh, so we're doing good on the rolly. That's what it seems to say. But I want you to remember, and I don't have the stats with me right now, under my watch, we got the best rankings for the Corruption Perception Index under the People's Partnership Government. When they came in, we fell and fell, so they got a lift by one rank. But when you read the details, there are two things. There's a ranking, and then there are the actual numbers. And you'll see there's not much change, none whatsoever. Now, when this came out, where are the PNM party groups that masquerade as civil society when the UNC is in government? Where is the PNM party group known as Transparency International in Trinidad? After 6 years of the PNM, all social indicators point to the negative. Corruption is rampant. But conveniently, Transparency Institute says, hey, we're less corrupt than 1 year ago. I want you to remember, this is the same TTI that is headed by Dion Abdul, who is corporate secretary at WASA. Worse yet, Fern Narcisse Cope, you know that name? The niece of former PNM MP and minister, who the chase don't remember from Ghana in that election. She is also on that TTI. She's also on that board. But we are supposed to take them on, believe what they tell us about the integrity of the PNM. Recuse us at every single cabinet meeting. I think we were counting about 200 recusals by ministers in the cabinet. Business enterprise, they're running. And yet, we're less corrupt 1 year later. Dollars, billions going to friends and families. And they say we are less corrupt. 210 recusals, found a number here. Never before seen in our history. Never before seen in our history. 81 million taken away from gate. But they had to pay rentals. And they say we are less corrupt. Talk about conflict of interest. After gutting the procurement legislation, all the obstacles involved in our independent institutions, how can we ever be less corrupt today? What has this institute ever said about that? About independent institutions for accountability being systematically undermined and compromised. Express in the papers did a simple online poll asking, if you think we are less corrupt today than 1 year ago, 78% of the respondents said no. They do not believe that. So where is the PNMTTI getting the information from? Must be the newly being built Balaji House. This is nothing but a PNM party group, so don't get taken and fooled. And you know, the former head of the TTI, you know when PNM won election, what they did? They made an ambassador. I think it's to Jamaica. Sent him off as their ambassador. See, he was a closet PNM all along running that TTI. So what good information can we depend on from another PNM group? Before I close, there are two matters I really must raise. One has to do with the NIB, and I have asked MP Tanku to file a matter on the adjournment for the sitting on Friday of the Parliament on the NIB. And the other is the EBC report, Death of Our Democracy. I've asked Khadija Amin, who is our local government shadow portfolio, to file a matter on the adjournment Friday, for Friday's sitting, so we can get some more information. So look, I can talk to you about this from my head. The National Insurance Board is a very important board. We see this institution, typical PNM style, ministers continue to hide. Under the law, the NIB was putting a report in the parliament every year. The board prepares a report, it is sent to the minister, and it was late. In that way, John Public, you, me, and all of us, we will know what's going on with the dollars in that NIB asset. So you must prepare this annual report. You have until September each year. They give it to the minister. The Minister of Finance must then lay it. The last two reports, 2019 and 20, the Minister of Finance was hiding them. It was only after I sent a pre-action lawyer's letter that he ran on the same day we putting the matter into the courthouse, and he laid it. We had to go to court to get those NIB reports. And the standard matter is still before the court, even though he has now complied with the law, because he was in breach of the law. When the court granted leave to sue the Minister of Finance, I say he ran to Parliament and laid those reports. We are in the same position now, with the 2021 report being hidden by the minister. And that report, he's in breach of the law. He should have laid our report since last year, November. We are now in February, tomorrow from tomorrow. Entering February, no report. Now we need to know what's in those reports because it tells us if the government is paying NIS contributions for workers. It tells us many other things, the asset base, how they've invested and how they will invest. And so we want to see that report. It also tells us, based on the number of contributors paying NIS, it really tells us how the workforce is dropping, how the unemployment is increasing. So we need to see that report. Under the Act Section 3, the minister has a statutory duty. And now he is in breach of that statutory duty. I have already drafted and intend to file in the court, file a pre-action letter first for something called a mandamus, which is an order compelling the minister to lay the report in Parliament. I will give you till Friday, Minister, and if you don't do your job under law, then we shall be heading to the courthouse. We will. Then I plan to speak about this, and I'm reading the story about a new chairman at the NIB. Some kind of conflict of interest. It's not a conflict, you know. It's a breach of the law. You have broken the law again to put this new man as chairman. The new chairman, Mr. Patrick Ferreira, was a director before he became the chairman. Now the law says a person who, in the opinion of the minister, is independent of government, business, and labor, that person shall be appointed chairman. But it is very clear that this gentleman, Ferreira, was a director before, and he was a pick of whom? The government. So three sets of people go in there. Labor reps, business reps, and government reps. And then out of these, now you have to select someone else who is not in business and is not a government appointee. So let's read this man's background. And I'll tell you why it's important in a minute. The chairman is exceedingly important. If you read the annual report 2020, and next to his name, you will see Mr. Patrick Ferreira, Director, Government. So there's no question that he was a government appointee. Handpicked choice. Further, on checking the company's registry, Mr. Ferreira is a director of the following five companies. You don't want to tell me that's a conflict with business and in breach of the law? Furnace Chemicals, Furnace Rentals, Furnace Properties Limited, Furnace Personal Services, and Furnace Investments. So first, breaching the law because he was handpicked by the government, and breaching law because he's clearly a businessman. You're not a director of a company if you're not into business. Further, the same cabinet appointed him a director on state companies, Trinidad and Tobago NGL Limited and NIPTEC. So this man seems to be a nice favorite choice of the PNM. So clearly, he's not independent from government. He was their pick. Then he was appointed on these two companies, TTNGL and NIPTEC, and then all these other companies, the five companies I read out for you. So the reason why the chairman must be independent from government, business and labor, is to seek the best interest of the NIB and its assets. The minister broke the law in contravention of that law. Mr. Imbed, your arrogance knows no bounds. And therefore, this chairman is clearly in breach of the law. And I said I'll tell you why it's important. The NIB has a lot of assets, money, investments. They collect when we pay NIS, when we work, they collect those monies. And they have funds, there's billions of dollars of taxpayers' funds. $25 billion, Taka is telling me. $25 billion sitting in the NIB. And then the NIB has to make decisions about what to invest in, where to invest, which company, where and where and how. So you can't have a man who clearly is in breach of the law there as a chairman, because we might find out that they're building a hotel here, or they're going to build something. They will make the choices. Do you understand what I'm saying? They will make the choice of where to invest your taxpayer dollars. And from the history of the NIB, we've seen where directors have, in the past, funded, invested in businesses with which they have close connections. And we know a cabinet that already recused itself from all of these. You think this board is going to recuse themselves when you have, what you said, $30 billion? $25 billion to invest. So where is Mr. Ferreira going to put his independence? Where? Which company? I think it was the one up hotel opposite the premises residence. Had a different name. I think NIB invested in that. I think it went busted. Now has a new name. What is it, JJ? You walking there, really? Bricks or something? Carlton Savannah it was. Yeah. NIB takes your dollars to invest where? Minister Imbed, please act according to law, man, and remove this man as a chairman forthwith. He come on the paper and saying, Ferreri, saying it's not about conflict. It's not about conflict of interest. It is that you are in breach of the law. With good reason, you must go too. Have some decency and just resign and just go. Just go. And if you don't, Imbed, Cabinet, Rowley, move him now. That's where you have to go. No. Let me talk to you about the EBC. I mentioned it earlier. But it's very important for me to just do this as I wrap up. So this is going on. You don't lay the NIB report. But you don't lay the EBC report. You don't lay the report. Let's see what's going on. Historically, the PNM has stifled democracy in our country. Under the former PNM regime, Manning, they delayed calling the local government elections. You remember that for year upon year upon year, year after year. They will not call the elections. They came with simple majority bills to the parliament to extend by 1 year, extend by 1 year, extend by 1 year. It is only when I became prime minister in 2010, I called the first local government elections in July 2010, the first in about 8 or 9 years they had delayed in calling them. Then under the Rowley PNM, the same thing happened. I sent a pre-action letter saying, look, the late councillor, may God rest his soul, Parashottam Singh for Davis South, had passed away February last year. You know. More than a year later, they failed to name a date. Once again, we had to send legal letters on and took them to court. They went kicking and screaming and named the 7th, money for that election day. And the same thing happened for Barataria in 2018 and for Belmont. Again, we had to send them lawyers' letters, and we took them kicking and screaming that they called the days for those two by-elections. The same thing I'm saying happened in Davis. So here we are again. Here we are again, Minister Kasim. I am told that you have received that EBC report. And why is it important? I mentioned, let me make it clear how important it is. It is the order of the EBC that sets the new boundaries for the local government elections due this year. Therefore, for parties, not just mine, any party, apart from the PNM, we must have sight of the report early enough to plan our candidacy, to plan the campaign, and to know what the boundaries are. But they're hiding it somewhere and will not they will not lay it in the parliament. Before elections are called, EBC prepares this report. I am told Khadija, I'm thinking, I'm saying, when is it, June last year? Yes? Yeah, we are told that this report has been sent since June last year. And they are hiding this report as well. I am also told, unofficially, a lot of boundary changes have been made in that report. So once again, I said MP Khadija will lay that matter for debate on Friday in the parliament as a matter on the adjournment. And if they still fail by Friday, we go into court. We'll send them legal documents. We must get the court to order that EBC report be laid in parliament. So those are some of the areas I wanted to speak to you about. And I want to tell you, never ever give up and never lose hope. No matter how sad things may seem today, God is great. God is great and he's always with us. So keep that hope and fire burning in your hearts. Reach out and help. My young candidate came right out. He said, let's hold hands together. Let's work together, and together we can get this wicked government out. So thank you all very much. May God bless you. May God bless Trinidad and Tobago. And again, thanks to all our dynamic speakers tonight. And we'll see you again. Maybe before next Monday, we'll be campaigning in Davis South with the team there. I've already asked you, let's not crowd the place too much because it's a small electoral district. And with the COVID protocols, we want to be very careful. Never let it be said that the UNC is engaging in bad protocols with the COVID. So if you do go campaign, I said, call the candidate, call Councillor Nicholas Kanai and MP Tanku, so we can roster you for different days. So we don't have the whole of the UNC down in Davis South. God bless. Thank you very much. Be safe. Go home safe.